How's it going, peeps? Welcome back to the channel. I know it has been a while since I have put out a pro show, but of course I want to do things properly. And my next guest tonight goes doesn't need any introduction. I'll give you a clue. I'll read off some of his stats. The stats are a long list that I had to write them down. He boasts an impressive record of 185 DStv Prem appearances, third mustering up 32 goals and 11 assists, 5 Telkom knockout appearances and 1 goal, 4 Nedbank Cup appearances and 1 goal, 4 MTN 8 appearances, 3 goals, having won that competition as well. He also boasts an impressive record of playing in the Allsvenskan, 34 apps, 34 appearances, 3 goals in League and Cup. So if you haven't figured it out yet, let me know. But till then, let's do the intro and let's get this going. So if you haven't figured it out, yes, I'll give you more clues. So let me give you a bit of insight as well. He has played for Ajax Cape Town, Platinum Stars, SuperSport United, Bloemfontein Celtic, Kuipermooie, and even applied his trade at Hammarby in Sweden. Allow me to welcome my guest, Mr. Nathan Paulser. How are you, sir?
Devin, I'm good. Thanks, man. Thanks for having me on the show this evening. And also welcome to all the viewers.
Thanks, man. I must admit, after following your career, I must have to be honest with you. I'm honored that you took the time to chat. So really, forgive me if I get a bit starstruck tonight. Eh? Just forgive me for that. But Ethan, let's get right into it. You've had an illustrious career. I want to start at the beginning. What made you get into football, first and foremost?
I think as a youngster, you know, the love of the game, you know, it's weird. All starts. Look, I'm from Athlone. My dad was an avid footballer. You know, he had his own club in the area, West End. As a youngster, you know, I played this from under 7. I think my first football match, you know, organized football was as a 5-year-old, and then from there, the love just grew. I remember back in the day, you know, every Saturday I was on the field from about 7 o'clock in the morning until about 6 o'clock in the afternoon. You know, you obviously play your game, and then I was under 7, and then after that, you watch each and every team play. But obviously, you as a youngster, you also on the side of the field, still having a ball on your feet, you know. And then I used to idolize the senior guys playing there, you know. And then that's where the love of the game, you know, grew.
Lovely. And then,
so yeah.
If I may ask, obviously being a striker, of course they were. Which strikers did you idolize?
The funny thing, I was a winger as a junior. I was a winger all the way up until under 17, and that's when I switched to being a striker. You know, I think for obvious reasons, you can't have the guy who's the tallest in the team being the guy on the wing. But yeah, players that I idolized, you know, from about the age of 16, 17, it was first Alan Shearer. He was
clinical.
He was at Blackburn then. I don't know if you recall. I'm not sure how old you are.
Yeah. No, I do. They won the league when he was there.
yes. So he had an awesome like a partnership with Sutton.
Chris
Sutton, you know, the two of them had so he was my first, I would say, idol. And then after him, it was Henri, you know, I used to idolize him when he was playing for Juventus, and then he moved to Arsenal, and at Arsenal he became a king, you know, and that's why until this day Arsenal is my team, you know, even though I don't want to say it too loudly.
We have something in common then.
Yes, I see so. Yeah, but they were the strikers who I idolized, I think, as a youngster, you know.
Lovely stuff. Look, I want to look. I don't want to touch. Of course, we're gonna touch on your playing career as well. You've been in the game a very long time, and of course, you've received a lot of criticism. How did you deal with that, and how did you manage to play at the top of your game for such a long time?
Look, I think a part of me, you know, always, or not a part of me, but a big reason why I wanted to be a pro, you know, is, you know, due to having a dream as a youngster. I remember in our school, I always used to write in essays, irrespective if the essay was about a day at the beach. You know, I would somehow include playing football on TV. You know, it was just a dream of mine. So look, I, you know, obviously being a pro and having to deal with that, the pressure of now being being paid to play, you know, and also having people see you play, you know, as a full-time job. It was a big experience at first. I dealt with a lot, you know. I was a favorite of the Boo Boys, you know. But look, I always say it's a package deal, you know. I knew that, you know, I made a choice. It's a dream of mine to be a pro player, you know. And a part of that deal of you saying to yourself that you want to be a pro player is the fact that you actually also saying to yourself that you allowing other people to have a view, you know, of you playing. You know, it's not a avoidable thing. You know, I can't say, you know, I want to be a pro, but, you know, I don't like fans. Because at the end of the day, the mere fact that you made a choice to want to go after this as a player and be a pro, it's a package deal. You know, I learned that the hard way. I must admit, you know, I went through tough times. You know, my family, we went through tough occasions where, you know, I'm seeing me play at home, you know, and being there amongst the fans who would boo me and swear at me, etc. Yeah. But look, these are all a part of this. You know, you know what I'm saying? And look, it built me. I learned, you know, how to deal with the pressure, and I think now it, you know, it stands me in good stead as a coach, you know. And I think that is why I'm one of the fewer players I can say, or you know, ex players, you know, who can handle pressure, you know.
Pressure as well.
It's a curse that I think I turned into a blessing and
True. Nah, I know what you mean when you say you get a lot of criticism, but in my opinion, you delivered. So look, you also played in Sweden. I want to ask you, what was that like? What are the difference between the Allsvenskan, and I hope I'm pronouncing it correct, I'm not butchering it,
yes,
and the PSL, and what challenges did you face whilst playing in Sweden?
So the difference for me was the intensity. I mean, there the intensity of the game was a lot higher. It was at a faster pace. Remember, I went there in 2008, you know, and back then the Swedish league wasn't as advanced as it is now. You know, I joined Hammarby. They were one of only maybe three or four teams in that league that actually played, you know, that actually passed the water ball. Everyone else was playing long ball,
you know. Okay.
And I'm talking about long ball in the direct sense of the word long ball. You have five at the back, five up front, you know. So for me, it was a shock. That kind of thing. I mean, I thought I was a target man, you know, coming from SA and stuff. By now, I mean, you never see. I haven't seen target men the way they want to play there. That was a straight route one. So yeah, look, route in terms one, of intensity, it was a difference. You know, it was a challenge at first. You know, everybody there is strong. So from that viewpoint, you know, I had to adjust. You know, you must remember back in the PSL, I was probably one of the tallest players. So here I go to a league where my height is the average height. You know, so
is the norm. So, you know, the norm.
Do you know what I'm saying? I had to get into the gym and improve. You know, on that side. You know, in terms of the strength, and then a challenge was, you know, obviously I think of culture. You know, that was a obstacle for me for my first, I would say, half a year. You know, because you have to know that I left home for the first time. You know, at the age of 25. You know, so I left my also mom and dad's house, and I went from being at home with your family around you. And I move abroad, and there I'm alone. You know, I have to fend for my myself. I have to cook. You know, I have to clean, and all these things I haven't done. You know, so these are all things that I had to learn. But you know, it was fun. I always say that, you know, I learned more about my self in those years I've spent playing abroad than I learned in my entire time playing here. You know, just how they approach you as a athlete and as a player, you know, and as a man as well. You know, you expected to do a job there, and they you know, handle you like a pro athlete. And that's a difference as well, you know, compared to playing here, PSL. Yeah, so no, but it was enjoyable. You know, I wish I had stayed there maybe a bit longer, but you know, things happen for a reason. But I enjoyed it,
of course,
thoroughly.
Nah, lovely. I never knew that, actually. Thank you for that insight. You're also running a stunning initiative currently at the moment, which is why I wanted you to come on the show tonight. Would you mind telling me about that initiative?
Yeah, no, cool. So, look. When tired, you there?
Yes, I'm here. I'm listening to you. I'm still here, Nathan. I'm still here.
Okay, cool. Sorry. So I was saying, cool, man. So I was saying, in August 2019, when I officially retired, you know, I started a company called Starting 11 Revolution, and that's a career development service for amateur players and pro. But it's more on the mental side of things, and I'll tell you why I started it. You know, all through was out my playing time as an amateur and as a pro. You know, I noticed that you know, we have players with amazing ability, but the one obstacle which I've seen most, you know, South African players have is the mental aspect is very very weak, and I say that in terms of intensity, in terms of pressure, in terms of handling that, and then also in terms of being a pro. You know, how do you you know, keep your form at a level that is acceptable, and because now you must know it's a job now. It's not exactly a hobby anymore. It's not anymore. You've been asked to play with your homeboys, you know, and it's a fun game. Now it's exactly a job. Now it's intensity. So how do you handle that, you know, and still be who you are as a person, you know, off the wash field. So I launched this service that offers a course, you know, for both amateur players and pros that walks them through, you know, the mindset, growth in terms of key Lovely. Elements that, you know, I experience as a pro player, you know, and as a man, key elements, you know, how you can be a elite athlete. Because at the end of the day, yes, you were a football player, but you are an elite athlete, you know, so you need an elite athlete's, you know, mindset. You know, so I equipped them well with that. And look, it's effective tools. I mean, in this last year and a half alone, we have mentored about, it's going on to 30 plus NFD and PSL players. And then as well, amateur boys, you know, I've mentored to watch a date. It's about 25 now, you know. So the amateurs I do in bigger groups, but
of course.
Pros it's more intimate. So
intimate one on one,
you know. So no, it's some smaller groups. Four, you know, maximum six, you know. Why? Because a pro, you know, he needs to be improved and addressed, you know, as soon as he can. Whereas a amateur player, he's on a process, you know. It's done online via Zoom, you know. So anywhere you are, you can be in Johannesburg. In actual fact, I had a player from America, join our course as well. So it's things which, you know, us as the have been, you know, speaking about for years. You know, we all know about your Jabu Pules and these guys, you know, the so-called bad boys, you know. But at the end of the day, people haven't asked, how do we help them? You know, how do you help, you know, a player that has all the ability, but you can see he comes from an environment where he needs some stability, you know, from his mindset, you know, how he looks after himself, you know. So we deal with issues like, you know, identity, self-awareness, self-belief, goals, how to set them, how to link it to your on-field, to your off-field, you know, and these things, you know, because it's important, you know, to you know, empower them from a human side. So that's what I've been doing, you know, since August 2019, apart from being a coach. It's been good. We were all in the process of you know, drawing up like a study guide, a book, so that you know, a player can have a tangible guide on him. So if he's in camp or where
he can go through it. You still there?
You were there.
Yeah, I'm still here. I can hear you.
Yes.
Carry on.
Okay, cool. So look, I mean, it's an important thing because, you know, especially nowadays, the industry has become so for players, you know, from the mental side, they need to be, you know, reinforced, you know, and assisted. So that the guide hopefully will be, you know, out them soon, and you know, a self-help kind of a guide, because it's interactive.
Okay.
You know, so the player fills in what he wants to achieve, how he wants to achieve it, what you know, the mindset he needs to adopt, you know, and it's a, you know, a weekly action plan with targets, you know. So it's interesting, it's exciting, that's also new for this industry, but it's essential, if you ask me. You know, I wish I had this tool as a youngster. So yeah,
exactly. I think it's an outstanding initiative, really, because like you said, there's a lot of talented footballers, but there's nobody actually to guide them in certain aspects. And really, I think it's brilliant. Another thing, which so obviously, of course, that obviously relates into professionalism. How important do you think professionalism is in football? And do you think the modern footballer takes professionalism for granted?
That's a very interesting question. You know, I don't think it's as easy to just answer with a blank answer, yes or no. I think the industry here in South Africa, you know, hasn't done enough to help our players see themselves as pros. So from that viewpoint, it's maybe a bit harder for our players nowadays to actually understand what it is to be a pro in the true sense of the word. Obviously, because nowadays players see themselves more as brands, you know, because with social media and Instagram having a huge impact on them, which you can't ignore. It's just on whether they understand that they must always work hard first, you know, and that's the important thing. So yeah, no, I think that, you know, players don't nowadays perhaps understand what it means perhaps to be a pro, you know, because I find that it's you know, too many of them have a, you know, half and half approach. You know, so I'm you know, I work hard on the field off. You know, I have a good game, or you know, I have, you know, a decent game, I'm happy. You know, but I have a large Instagram account. You know, I have a sponsor who can give me a pair of boots or whatever, which is all good and well. But for me, I come from the school of the horse, you know, pulls the cart, you know, and not the cart comes before the horse, you know. So you as a footballer must always work hardest, you know, because at the end of the day, if people think back about you as a player, then the first thought that should come to people's mind is that he was a top a pro and player,
100%,
you know, and
100%.
Not that he was you know, a model first and then a player, you know. So
Correct.
So look, it's tough, you know, because industry from what their side is not helping them here, and as well, you know, the culture now, you know, in society, you know, it's a very instant one, you know. There's hardly a process anymore. Of like, you as a young player, you know that within the next 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 years, I have a goal. Now it's about instant. You know, you can be a 18-year-old and be a star, you know, either on the field or off the field. So yeah, I know it's an interesting one. But again, you know, if you look at, for example, Ronaldo, I mean, he's the perfect pro. I mean, for Washington, yes, he's a world-class player, but the reason why he's well-known is because he always does the job on the field. Always. You know,
always,
and that's why
he can
be a brand, you know, off the
on his own
field. You know, yeah. He doesn't have to push his brand hard, you know, off the field, because on the field he does his job, and that's a pro. So yeah,
100%. I couldn't agree with you more. Look, we are coming to the end. Lastly, if you could give a message to any young footballer aspiring to be the next Nathan Poulser, what message would you give them?
I would say the most important thing is know why you want to be a pro player. If it's for the instant fame and the success and Instagram and the sponsored boots and all this kind of stuff, you in for, you know, a frightening reality. You know, it's not all players that experience that, you know. So that's the first advice I would give. Know exactly why you want to become a pro, and also understand that, you know, attach it to a, you know, off the field goal and a life goal. Like if you want to look after your family, or you want to build your mom and dad a house, or things like that. You want to have a business, and then you know, of course. I would say as well, learn how to deal with the pressure, because the mere fact that you have a dream to become a pro player means that at some point or other you will face obstacles. You will,
of course,
you know, and if you don't know how to handle that, you know, it can mean a short way down, or it can mean, if you handle it in a positive way, it can mean that you now have, you know, a 20-year football a journey, you know, and that's an awesome thing. So yeah, that's the advice
I'll give you. Lovely. So yeah, we've come to the end of this awesome chat. Nathan, I want to thank you again. Again, like I said, I'm humbled. Like, you've had a stunning career, and your initiative off the field is brilliant. I think it really adds value. I want to wish you all the best with that initiative that you're running. Keep going, and I'm sure it's only going to go from thing to thing. So I want to thank you for jumping on.
Awesome stuff, my man. And then I just wanted to add, if anybody does want to reach out with regards starting 11 Revolution, they can do so. It's on Instagram under starting XI Revolution. That's okay. That's starting XI Revolution. And then as well, they can email us at sxirinquiries@gmail.com. And then we can give them all the information on that.
Cool. Awesome. I'll share it when I share the link to the video, and I'll put it in the description of this video as well.
Okay. Awesome stuff, man.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, have an awesome evening, Nathan. Keep well, eh?
You cheers, as well, man. Thanks.